Good evening. My name's Stanley Bill, and I'm the coordinator of the Polish Studies Initiative at the Department of Slavonic Studies here at Cambridge. And I'd like to welcome you all very warmly here to Sydney Sussex College and the University of Cambridge for another Cambridge Polish Studies event. As many of you know, this initiative involves an academic program, a teaching program, but also a lively cycle of public events. Of which this is one. We have a very varied schedule. Some of you a couple of weeks ago were at our event on Jewish life in Poland today. On December 8th, we have a conference on Polish political thought. In January, we're hosting a film screening, a film by Jan Komasa. The director will be here for that, as well as a debate on Polish foreign policy between Radosław Sikorski and Andrzej Nowak. And then in March, we're inviting the Polish novelist Dorota Masłowska. So you can tell we have a very diverse set of events for you, and they're all public events, and you're all very, very welcome to join us for those events. Please keep an eye on our website. Just put Cambridge Polish Studies into Google, you'll find us. This evening, we have a very important discussion ahead of us. And in fact, it's a discussion which is a continuation of a conversation that we've already been having here at Cambridge. It's in fact exactly 1 year ago today, it was November 18, 2015, that we held an event under the title, Are Poles at Home in Britain? A Public Forum on Immigration. Now, at this event, we hosted Polish and British experts who talked about the current situation as it then was for Poles living in the UK. We examined the triumphs and challenges of the last 10 years, while also looking to the uncertain future, a future that has become much less certain for all of us. We talked about what Poles have brought to British culture, what prompted them to migrate, how many wish to return, what kinds of discrimination they face, how the rest of British society views the Polish contribution, and what effect migration has had in Poland. We talked about all of these issues a year ago, and since then, things, as we all know, have changed dramatically after the referendum in June. Today, we want to talk about what effect that event might have on the Polish community here in the UK. But of course, that's a much broader discussion. It affects communities from a whole number of other European Union nations, people living and working who have made their lives here, who have established their families here, their careers here. And we want to hear those voices today. And for that reason, the idea of this event is to come together with representatives of the Polish community from Cambridge, here in front of me, from other parts of the UK, on our specialist panel, with two honoured guests to contribute, but also to listen to those voices. And those guests are, before I introduce the panellists, the Ambassador of the Republic of Poland in the United Kingdom, Arkady Rzegocki, who will speak to us in a few moments. But also, and this may not have been in the information that some of you had when you signed up for this event, we're extremely happy to have with us the British ambassador to Poland, Mr. Jonathan Knott. But let me introduce our panelists sitting at the table in alphabetical order, also nearest to me here, Professor Kenneth Armstrong. He's a professor of European law at the University of Cambridge and a fellow of this college. And Kenneth has written extensively in the field of European Union law and policy, with a particular focus on the evolving governance and institutional structures of the EU. So Kenneth is going to tell us a little bit here about some of the scenarios, some of the legal scenarios that might play out in ways that affect all of us, but in particular the Polish community. We have Aneta Buchert, who is sitting at the end of the table, and she is a member of the advisory board and former president of the Polish City Club, an organization of Polish professionals committed to building a well-connected and successful Polish diaspora in the UK, but also more broadly in Europe. She works in capital markets, and she has an MBA from the École Supérieure de Commerce in Paris. Next to Aneta is Elizabeth Kardynal, who is a trustee of the Federation of Poles in Great Britain. And she's also the founder of the Polish School and the European Welfare Association in Walsall near Birmingham. And then finally, in the middle of the table, we have Jakub Krupa, who is the UK correspondent for the Polish press agency based in London. He's also a regular contributor to The Guardian and also to the Polish weekly Przekrój, and an activist working with the Polish community in Britain. So could you please join me in welcoming all of our guests this evening? So the order of events for the evening will be that first we'll hear an introductory word from the Polish ambassador, Professor Rzegocki, and to say a little something about him. Well, he's the ambassador extraordinary and plenipotentiary of the Republic of Poland to the Court of St. James, but he's also a political scientist and professor at the Jagiellonian University in Krakow, where he specializes in Polish and English political thought. It's also worth noting that this evening is something of a homecoming for Ambassador Rzegocki, since he is a former visiting scholar of Sydney Sussex College. So welcome back, Ambassador. Jonathan Knott was appointed Her Majesty's Ambassador to Poland in April 2016, and he was previously Her Majesty's Ambassador to Hungary between February 2012 and April 2015. So after Ambassador Rzegocki's opening word, we'll hear a few words from Ambassador Knott. Then we'll have short presentations from all of our panelists, after which we will throw the floor open to discussion, questions and comments from all of you directed at the four panelists here on the table. And then after all of that, I'd like to welcome you all upstairs to the old library here at Sydney Sussex College for a glass of wine and an informal continuation of our conversation this evening. So first of all, could you please join me in welcoming Ambassador Arkady Rzegocki.
Ambassador, distinguished panelists, organizers, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, I wish to thank the renowned University of Cambridge and Sydney Sussex College, and personally Dr. Stanley Bill, for organizing this conference, which focuses on the matter which, without a doubt, is the most discussed topic among Poles living in the United Kingdom since the June referendum. Since Poland's accession to the European Union, thousands of my fellow countrymen arrived to the United Kingdom in search of better economic prospects, an opportunity to gain international experience, or starving for a world-class education. It's worth to remember that back to in 2004, the British, the Irish, and the Scottish governments were the only ones to decide not to curtail free movement of workers from the new member states. Such a step has been seen in Poland as a real evidence that the United Kingdom truly embraces the concept of freedom and wants to share it with the nations which reject communist oppression and took the difficult path towards democracy and free market economy. I recognize the fact that to many, the scale of the inflow of Poles into the British Isles was somewhat surprising and challenging. Yet, I argue that the overall picture is a very positive one, both to the UK and the Polish community. According to the British statistics, employment among Poles who came here is higher than the average for the overall population. They pay their taxes, they pay their taxes and contribute to the local communities. At the same time, the percentage of Polish accessing benefits and social assistance is lower than for the general British population. Using the EU jargon, one could say that Poles in the UK are net payers to the Treasury. Unfortunately, the result of the referendum in June was seen by some as a legitimation of their xenophobic beliefs. But these extreme and marginal attitudes were countered 1,000 times thanks to vast support and help from the representatives of all major political parties, local communities, and many individuals who condemned this deplorable acts of hate crimes. Our institutions and the law enforcement are cooperating closely with relevant British authorities to tackle hate crime and xenophobia. We are determined to boost the awareness of the positive contribution of the Polish diaspora to the British society and look forward to working together with all the stakeholders who can facilitate reaching this aim. In this context, I am greatly encouraged by many statements of key political figures in Whitehall and Westminster who acknowledge the contribution of Poles to the prosperity of this country and express how welcome we are here. These words are important not only to me and to my government, but first and foremost to over 900,000 Poles living in England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland. Yet, these positive signals should now be translated into the new framework of EU-UK relations. Poland is ready to take active part in these negotiations and has underlined the importance of carrying this process out in an organized way. That requires triggering Article 15 first. The announcement by Prime Minister May expressing her intention to do so before the end of March 2017 brings some clarity to the process concerning the time frame. However, the future legal status of the European Union nationals, including Poles living in the UK, is far from clear. Poland is of an opinion that the rights of the Polish nationals already living in the UK should be respected also after formal departure of the UK from the European Union. Moreover, we would very much welcome it if the UK remained a part of the single market, which brings benefits to all of us. Yet, this can only be seen in conjunction with a respect for the integrity of all four fundamental freedoms. I believe that for the sake of the good of EU-UK relations, the future settlement should be based on the rule of reciprocity, including rights and obligations of respective EU and UK nationals, and as regards market access. Despite the outcome of the referendum, the UK will continue to be a pivotal partner for the EU and bilaterally for Poland in both political and economic dimensions. The best example for this cooperation is the whole range of very intensive political and expert contacts at all levels. Our businesses cooperate closely and the UK is the second largest investor in Poland. Polish-British trade continues to flourish. There are vibrant academic contacts which we want to enhance even further. Thus, while regretting the British decision to leave the EU, we fully respect it and look forward to the future cooperation with the United Kingdom, one of Poland's key friends and allies. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Rzegocki. I'd now like to welcome to the lectern Ambassador Knott, and I'd like to add my own comment to his presence here, which I would interpret as a very positive sign that the British government is listening or willing to listen to the voices of Poles in this country, and that's why we're very, very pleased to have him here. Welcome.
Ladies and gentlemen, dobry wieczór, good evening, and thank you for not making me speak in Polish tonight. That's a feature of many of the speeches I make, and I think I make the audience suffer nearly as much as they make me. But thank you also, Stanley, for organizing this evening. As you've heard, I was really keen to come along. I was keen to come along because this sort of event, the work that this college, that Stanley's doing, I think can make a really big contribution to what I'm trying to do in Warsaw. Because essentially my job in Warsaw, the British government's aim is to take the relationship between Poland and the UK and take it from somewhere which is good and make it great. Those are instructions that Mrs. May gave to me when she came across just 10 days after she was made Prime Minister in Warsaw. The same instructions I got when the Foreign Secretary came across to Warsaw right at the beginning of September, very shortly after he started. And of course, one of the big elements of that relationship, if you like, is the Polish community here in the UK. Arkady, Stanley's already mentioned the contribution that Poles have made to the UK, and that's a contribution which, happily, our ministers and the Prime Minister have talked about already. It was really great, I think, that our Minister for Europe celebrated Independence Day of Poland with Arkady and said at that moment and in his tweets that he appreciated the contribution of the Poles to the UK. It's a message that Mr. Johnson's also made. What I think I'd like to do, what I need to do, is to understand much better the Polish community in the UK. I understand, I've read from the Office of National Statistics, gosh, English is difficult too, isn't it? That there are 916,000 Poles in the UK now. That now, of non-UK born people, the Poles are the biggest community in the UK. They're an important part of the UK, they're an important part of Poland as well. And so as Arkady and I work on that relationship, this is a part that we need really to understand, that I need really to understand. So that's why I was so grateful to Stanley when I found out about this evening. I don't have a prepared speech to give to you. I feel I'm here really to listen, to understand, to be told about what some of the issues are, to make sure that I understand them. So I'm really looking forward to the conversation. I hope it will be a conversation. I might jump in once or twice during the course of that conversation. But I wanted to thank you in advance for participating. Thanks for letting me come. Thanks to the panel for your part in making sure that I know what I need to do. And I'm really looking forward to it. Thanks for your hospitality.
I'd like to welcome immediately to the lectern
and now Jakub Krupa.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for inviting me, and it's a great pleasure to be here again. I took part in the previous debate about Poles in the UK, and it's a great, great opportunity for me to be here again. I have been asked to talk generally about the situation of Poles in this country and about the future in the UK after Brexit. Now, since not many journalists predicted Brexit, I'm sort of doubtful about the crystal balls we have in newsrooms, but maybe I'll be able to give you some sort of answers. However, I have to say that I'm quite worried that the most insightful answer I can come up with is, I don't know. Why is that? First of all, quick disclaimer, as a UK correspondent for the Polish press agency, I should not have opinions. So whatever I say here today is just a fact or a description of a fact or someone else's opinion, which may or may not necessarily be close to my opinion. first of all, as a matter of fact, Brexit has not happened yet. And we need to remember about that. It's yet to happen. We don't know when it will happen. It's a long time to go. But what we know now, there's a huge vacuum and uncertainty that affects many Polish people in this country. Obviously, the most prominent example of that is the rise in hate crime. I know we all know the numbers. We know that the 41% increase in hate crimes in the UK after Brexit in July compared to July last year. We all heard about the most sort of prominent cases, graffiti on the Polish Social and Cultural Association in London, leaflets in Cambridgeshire, graffiti on War Memorial in Portsmouth, obviously Harlow and the killing of a Polish man that alleged to be a hate crime. We still don't know that yet. Our attacks in Leeds and many other places. Now, these are the cases we know about. The question is, which I think we will be trying to answer today as well, how many cases we don't know about. And I would dare to say that most of the cases we don't know about. Quite often when I go to many places in the UK, people tell me, like, we don't know whether we should report that or not. Most of them go, you know, it's not serious enough. I've seen people being verbally abused on my eyes, in front of my eyes. When I spoke to them after that, I said, like, you should report that to the police. They say, that's not serious enough. And that's one of the misconceptions we need to tackle. We need to make these people aware of the fact that it is a hate crime and they should report that. Now, as Ambassador Knott rightly said, Polish population here is quite big. We have new figures from June this year, and the nationals, Polish nationals living in the UK, the actual number now is 984,000. Now, that does not include Polish people that have dual citizenships, which means that the real number is way over the million, which as soon as Daily Mail find out, obviously we'll have some attractive covers about that. We know a bit about them. We don't know much about them. We have done a public opinion poll just before Brexit and just after Brexit, asking the Polish population in this country how they feel about the future in the UK. Now, we have seen a huge swing in the opinions after Brexit. 74% of them said they are worried about negative attitudes towards migration. That was, mind you, first week of July. We expect that to be much higher today. New figures will come next week or the week after that, so we'll see what that number is now, but this is a huge, huge change. Despite that, and I think that's important when we talk about the Polish community in the UK, 79% of them, after Brexit, said that their future is in the UK and they want to stay in the UK, whatever happens. So when we talk about the Polish community in this country, I think the question that we quite often get as journalists, Polish journalists from British journalists, is, oh, so how many Polish people are going back? Now, I think it needs to be said from this reflector now, most of those people are not going back, and they will not go back, they will stay in the UK. And we need to make sure that it works, as Prime Minister Theresa May says, it's the country that works for everyone. Now, another interesting stat is that we know that the same people we interviewed after Brexit, when we asked them whether they feel personally accepted in the UK as individuals, most of them, 65%, yes. When we asked them about whether they feel accepted as Poles living in the UK, most of the answers were no. They thought that Polish people in the UK would not accept it. And I think that's a big, big problem. That reflects a wider atmosphere. That I've visited a lot of cities in the last couple of weeks and months, traveling extensively across the UK, in Harlow, Peterborough, Leeds, Northampton, Corby, Birmingham, Reading. Everywhere the questions were the same, like, what are we going to do now? What shall we do to protect ourselves from Brexit? I'm sure we will have legal answers, we have sort of cultural, educational answers to that, we have business answers to that, and some answers perhaps from my journalistic point of view. But certainly what we need to be aware is that most of Poles living in the UK have been, as I said, here for more than 5-6 years. They are here permanently. They're not willing to come back. So instead of asking, what we can do to get them back to Poland, I think the real question here is how we can make that work for them here in the UK. One of the biggest questions for me personally, there are two big questions. One is about the £4, and actually that's, in my opinion, the single most important reason why some people may decide to go back to Poland. And when I spoke with some of the low-skilled workers, they said if the pound goes below 4.50, they will go back to Poland. It's not far away from the stiff exchange rate. So that's something to definitely to watch. The other one is a lot of narrative about migration we've had before the referendum and after the referendum was about low-skilled workers in the UK, Polish workers who undercut the standards, who take some other people's jobs and so on. Now, it's increasingly clear that this narrative has had a negative effect on high-skilled workers and professionals living in the UK. A lot of them feel uncertainty, a lot of them feel that they're not welcome anymore. And I think this sort of ideal scenario that many people expressed before the referendum, that we can limit the low-skilled immigration to the UK, but keep the high-skilled immigration to the UK, and they want to stay in the UK, is just increasingly clear that's not true. And we need to be aware of that. And I'm sure we'll be discussing that later, but that's just sort of introduction from me. But I said, what's life like after Brexit? I don't know, and that's not just me flirting with the audience, that's just real answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Jakub. I'd like to welcome now to the lectern Aneta Buchert from the Polish City Club in London.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for inviting me here to speak about Polish professionals. So I'm speaking about Polish professionals. I am one of the Polish professionals, having worked for the last 10 years in the City of London, but I've also been very much involved with the Polish City Club and the Polish professional community over the last 7 years. So I've been in the center of a lot of feedback from what's happening in the Polish professional community and how this community is reacting to the Brexit. Well, firstly, let me answer the question, why is Polish professional community important? Because some people may say it's very small. And the 1 million or so Polish people that are here in the UK, the Polish professionals form a really small fraction. And if we think about those who live in London, and this is the group that I want to focus on, it is relatively small, but it is, I would say, very important. And why it's very important? It's very important because it helps to change the, it helps to broaden the image of Poland in the UK as a nation that has a wide range of skills to offer, from those people who can help us with the basic works to those people who can be established university professors, city traders, doctors, and practically very successful people in every profession. And the importance of Polish professionals has also been demonstrated to me when I had a chance last week to speak to a journalist from the Financial Times who's been writing an article about the Polish professionals in London, in the UK, and this article was published in the Financial Times on the same day as the US election, and the article about Polish professionals in London was the second most read article on the Financial Times website, and it's been a cause for a lot of discussion, and I think it shows two things. Well, firstly, people are interested in us as Poles, and they are very emotional about what's happened after Brexit. And that's been visible in the sort of 600 plus comments that have come up after this article. But also Polish professionals and Polish people are exemplifying a broader group of people, and that is professionals in the UK. Because in the end, Brexit affects us the same way as it affects the Germans and the French and the Italians, in the sense that if we are here, we're having professional jobs, we're doing the same roles as other nations. In the end, we are affected in a very similar way. So the Polish professionals, I think, from what I see, from the feedback I'm getting, I think we're living it a little bit in a bubble, especially the ones who live in London, because I think we see that this is a very international environment. A lot of Polish professionals are working in big companies, and they don't feel like they are in any way, different or from any other colleagues, British colleagues or the Western European colleagues. And I think everybody in London has been thinking that it's such an international environment, and everybody wants to be part of this environment. So Brexit has been a huge shock. So I think as a group, the professionals have been really surprised by the outcome. But as a group, it's a group that's reasonably insulated. From my conversations with my friends and colleagues, it seems that the professional environment is reasonably tolerant, and it's reasonably, at least politically, correct. So those who have been discussing Brexit and with their colleagues generally have not had any negative comments. On the contrary, there may have been jokes, but mostly in a positive context. However, what I've seen is that if you go beyond the professional environment to sort of more local places, like a local market, or talk to a neighbor, then those negative reactions may happen. And that I have been told of some examples like that. But anyway, as I said, I think the professionals are reasonably insulated. They are mostly very well educated. They're hardworking. They are ambitious, and they basically have a lot of choice. And a lot of those people, maybe they are not very visible in the grand scheme of things and in the grand number of Polish people, but they are progressing in various professions, and the number is growing significantly. In terms of the impact on those professionals so far, from what I see, and as I said, the comments most have been positive, some have been negative outside of the professional environment, but the real impact so far has been very limited, because it's really you know, the process of leaving the EU hasn't started. The economic consequences are not clear yet, and they probably take several years to materialize. And so, effectively, the effect has been mostly psychological. So it's been mostly people thinking, do I still feel comfortable in a place where half the population has voted for Brexit? Does it change my attitude? Does it make a trigger? Maybe I've been thinking about leaving the country. Is it an extra trigger? Or does it mean that certain of the jobs that were available here will be moved to a different country? And so basically, I can go and work somewhere else where maybe the housing market is not so inflated and I can have a slightly better quality of life and simply, you know, establish my life somewhere else. But as I said, so far, it's not been a material impact. So I think what will have happened now, everybody will be watching the negotiations and especially for London, and especially for the financial services, things like, is it a hard Brexit or soft Brexit? Do we keep the passporting rights, and are the financial institutions allowed to do the business on the same in the same way and the same rules as they used to while the UK has been a member of the EU? These are the really quick questions, and if the rights are maintained and the job losses in the financial services, for instance, are relatively contained, then I think there will not be a major change for the Polish professionals here. However, if the negotiations mean that that London loses some of its financial services jobs and loses some of its rights in terms of what it can do in the financial markets, then that is a much more serious consequence. And what we will see is more unemployment, and that will obviously impact everybody, including the Polish people. So, as I said, I'm reasonably upbeat on the Polish professionals. I think as a group, they will be doing well, and I think they are adaptable and will find their way either here or somewhere else. So that's probably the easiest group of the Polish society to discuss here, and the one which I think will be doing fine, and hopefully will be able to support other groups of the Polish society which may profit from that help and support. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Aneta. Now I'd like to welcome to the lectern Elizabeth Kardynal. And I should point out that Elizabeth's from the Birmingham area, and it's very important that we get voices from outside London. It's very easy to be very London-centric. So we're going to get the voice of a bloody foreigner from Birmingham in that case. Okay. Please welcome Elizabeth.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Ambassador Rzegocki, Mr. Ambassador Knott, ladies and gentlemen, panelists. Where do I start? I suppose it's since I'm a bloody foreigner and since I'm not in London, but in the lovely city of Cambridge, I feel safe. Thank you very much. I'm going to share with you a few real life stories. I think that's quite important from my point of view, and I'll tell you a little about why I believe it's important. 23rd of March, I was observed by the principal. I worked for 13 years as a head of department working in one of the secondary schools in Walsall, not in Warsaw. In Walsall, that's the little forgotten town near Birmingham. And I did a lesson on history of EU and the role of EU for Europe with my students aged 14 to 18 from all over the world. I failed that lesson. It was inadequate. It was one of the reasons why I thought, you know what, I've had enough, I'm moving somewhere else now. And my principal said afterwards, so I thought you were either very brave or crazy. I couldn't quite decide which one. Then the 24th of June, my son, who's 18 next year and just about to go to university, it might be Manchester, got downstairs very, very angry. And he said something between the lines, the news were obviously on, "Mom, it was the narrow-minded, it was the delusional people who decided about my future in this country, in Europe, before referendum, he would describe himself as European. He came to England when he was only 4 years old, so he spent all his life pretty much in England. And you know what? And it was the first time he said to me, "Mum, can you contact the embassy? Could you renew my Polish passport?" Okay, so I thought that's actually quite a positive aspect of all that. Tomorrow is Saturday, right? Tomorrow at 9 o'clock in the morning, we're going to open the doors of our Polish supplementary Saturday school. 300 children, over 300 children, aged 3 to 18, will enter the doors with the parents. It just happens I'm the head teacher of that school. Since September, this academic year, we got an increase of over 100 students who came to our school and said, we want to be part of this school. I take it as a huge positive. I am an optimist. To me, the glass is always half full, not half empty. I think what we've got here is, we all have got choices, ladies and gentlemen, don't we? You make your life wherever you are. It's up to you. How are you going to leave that? I remember when Jakub contacted me, he was doing this article for the Christian paper, and he said, Elizabeth, could you just give me an indication what it means to you? How Brexit affected you, your life? And I said, you know what? I had the choice. I could panic like everybody else and share this sense of hysteria across the country. I could go, right, okay, I don't agree with all this. I'm going to take a firm stand and I'm going to make sure that my life here means something, not just to me, not just to my family, but others as well. And that's what I've been trying to do ultimately for the last 12 years. And I found the British nation one of the most hospitable, generous people to work with, to be with, to an extent where this year, the organization we founded back in 2009 has been formally shortlisted for Queen's Award in voluntary sector. So please keep your fingers crossed, because I think it would be pretty, you know, significant achievement. We are a very strange nation, Poles, aren't we? We really are. And I suppose, and this is the time, and I always, because I work with young people, I always see this enormous potential we've got, and it doesn't matter whether we live in London, because London is a very, very specific place in the world, isn't it? Because you know the saying that there is London, there is nothing else for a very long time, and then there is the rest of the world. And that's how we feel sometimes. But professionals are all over, Aneta. The Polish professionals are all over, working in high-profile jobs across the country. We're scattered across the country, and I believe we make a great contribution, not just to our own community, but of course to the wider community in Great Britain. And I'm very proud of being Polish, and I'm also very proud of being British. So I would like to share with you these positive notes that we don't know. Of course we don't know. I agree with Jakub. How can we predict what's going to happen? Let's just make it work for all of us. Let's just make sure that that sense of hysteria, this ridiculous, you know, sense of fear. I refuse to be led by fear, by wrong emotions. I want to stick to the facts. I want to make my life as happy, as successful as possible, and I'm going to do it. Hence, I moved after 12 years of working in education to working now with CEO of one of the largest charities in West Midlands, and I work with rights and equalities, working on migration and equality, and I hope I'll do a good job at it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for those words. I'd like to welcome to the lectern now Professor Kenneth Armstrong.
Thank you very much. So Ambassador Rzegocki, Ambassador Knott, distinguished guests, Stanley, thanks so much for inviting me here tonight to say a few words about Brexit and the implications that it will have on the rights of Polish nationals in the UK, but also perhaps also UK nationals in Poland. And I've got some written remarks, and I'll say them, and they're relatively small in number. But I'm very aware that the things that I will talk about are really quite abstracted from the things that the other panelists have talked about. And actually, what may be really important, what really matters, is what happens on the ground and how we choose as individuals to live our lives and the kind of bonds of solidarity that we choose to make or not. Nonetheless, let me turn to what it was I was actually going to say. So it's perhaps a remarkable aspect of the European Union that we can talk at all in terms of the individual rights and their potential loss post-Brexit. After all, the European Union is an international organisation founded by states, typically for states, but as the European Court of Justice stated in one of its foundational judgments in the early 1960s, says the treaties are more than an agreement between member states. They also create rights for individuals which form part of their legal heritage. And there's a very important statement of principle that the European Union had to have meaning for individuals and not just for governments. And of course, it's not just the founding treaties, but also the legislative acts adopted by the member states working together with the European Parliament that are the source of a wide range of rights, from non-discrimination in the workplace to consumer protection. And these rights do not merely exist in legal texts. They can be enforced in courts, and especially in national courts. Now, in the case to be heard in the UK Supreme Court next month on whether the UK government has domestic legal authority to trigger Article 50, this question of the loss of EU rights is actually at the heart of the case for those arguing that the UK Parliament must authorise the triggering of Article 50 and so provide constitutional and legal authority for any consequential loss of rights. So what rights exactly do EU citizens stand to lose? Now, the legal case that has been brought by Gina Miller and others and heard in the High Court last month actually quite usefully categorises the rights that may be lost. And it's that scheme that I want to use because I think it's actually quite helpful for us. Now, the first category of rights that are recognised by the High Court are those rights which could be replicated in domestic legislation post-Brexit. Now, as it happens, rights which derive from EU directives are already part of UK law. They're already brought into UK law and will remain in UK law. So where individual rights for workers or consumers are protected, regardless of their nationality, then those rights will be available to anyone resident and working in the UK, unless and until Parliament decides to vary or remove those rights. And the aim of the so-called Great Repeal Bill is paradoxically not to repeal much of this EU-derived legal framework, but actually to retain it in place, again, unless and until Parliament decides to vary the rights protected in UK law. Now, when it comes to instruments like the EU Citizenship Directive, which establishes rights to residence and non-discrimination in another member state, such rights are currently dependent on the rights holder having the status of a European Economic Area national. Now, that status, of course, for Polish nationals in the UK will remain unchanged. After all, Polish nationals with Polish nationality will remain EU citizens. So when the UK leaves the EU, their rights to that extent will be unchanged. So in principle, there'd be no automaticity to any loss of rights and protection for Polish nationals in the UK unless a change was made to UK law limiting the scope of application to only certain nationals. The same could not necessarily be said, of course, for UK nationals in Poland, who would no longer be citizens of an EU member state and therefore would no longer have rights derived directly from EU law as EU nationals. And it's this, the rights of UK nationals in another member state is the second category of rights which is identified by the High Court. And again, where those rights apply without any distinction based on nationality, then they will continue to be enjoyed. However, free movement rights and other citizenship rights do depend on status and nationality, and their protection could require action at EU level or indeed at national level among the EU 27 to protect them against loss. And one of the key issues that once Article 50 is triggered will have to be resolved is whether the withdrawal agreement needs to put in place arrangements to protect rights in that way. It's not just the right to live and work that's at stake. There's also broader entitlement to equality of treatment, including in social and tax advantages. Now, the third category of rights that is recognised by the court are those which simply could not be replicated in UK law. These include certain political rights, that is, the right to stand for and vote in elections to the European Parliament. But importantly, it also includes the right to seek judicial protection through national courts, with the capacity of those courts to seek an authoritative interpretation of EU law from the European Court of Justice. And it's this last category I want to say a little more about. Now, much of the referendum debate simply focused on the idea that as a result of EU membership, laws were no longer being made in the UK, but imposed from Brussels. Not only did this debate ignore the fact that these laws actually created rights for individuals, it also ignored the capacity of individuals to enforce those rights in domestic law, in domestic courts. So my point is that when we think about what sorts of rights we will or not be able to extend to Polish nationals in the UK, one right you cannot get back is the right to have access to the Court of Justice via the UK courts. That right will, of course, be lost to UK nationals in the UK. And yet it is through this mechanism, the so-called preliminary ruling mechanism, by which national courts can send questions of interpretation to the Court of Justice, that the meaning and application of EU law is developed. And once the UK leaves the EU, this procedural mechanism will be lost, and with it, the binding effect of such rulings in domestic courts. Now, of course, for some, this is an outcome very much to be welcomed. No longer will UK courts be bound by the rulings and judgments of the European Court of Justice. The idea of interference in the domestic legal system by a foreign court is viewed by some as, in fact, a primary reason for leaving the EU. Taking back control would seem to imply control by our own courts. Yet, as the experience of the Article 50 case in the High Court has illustrated, even our courts and the independence of the judiciary appear to be fair game for media attacks. And I'm afraid to say, with a government meekly sitting on its hands while it happens. So in closing, I want to insist on something that I think needs to be kept in mind. When we think about what sort of rights we want to see protected after Brexit, whether these are the rights of Polish nationals in the UK or UK nationals in Poland, we also need to protect the institutions and structures through which citizens can obtain judicial protection. And the European Union has been an important means of promoting a culture for the protection of rights and the rule of law. Leaving that behind exposes us all to great risks. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Armstrong. Before I open the floor to some questions, I just want to, in a way, follow Elizabeth's lead to really emphasize the positive aspects of the situation for Polish communities in the UK by just asking a couple of the panelists, at least, to remark upon what they see as being the key achievements of this enormous Polish migration to the UK, especially since 2004. But of course, we shouldn't forget the earlier Polish community that was already here. But if we could talk about what we see as being the triumphs and achievements of those communities and what Polish communities have brought to British society more broadly. If we could just briefly speak to that before we open the floor to further discussion.
Well, since I'm an educationalist, I'd say a huge, huge brain power. This potential within the young professionals, not just professionals, the inventions, the impact we've had in infrastructure, in economy, in education. That, from my point of view, is one of the greatest contributions the Poles have made to this country.
Well, I think one of the important things Polish people have achieved is that whenever you talk about Polish people and somebody tells you, you know, I've worked with a Polish person on, and they've helped me to, I don't know, take care of my children, or they've helped me to do some things at home, or they've helped me to do whatever the Polish people have done for a person, generally it gets positive feedback. So I think Polish people have established have been renowned now for doing good job basically. And I think the challenge now is that we want to show, and at least I would like to show the British public, that Polish people are great at what they do, in the whole sort of spectrum of things. So we can have great plumbers, but we can have great CEOs of, you know, FTSE 100 companies. And I think that's the sort of that I would think is an ambition for years to come. It will probably not be very quick, but I think it's something that we should sort of all aspire to, that we can do all the same things we would be able to do in Poland. We do them very well. We get the reputation, we maintain the reputation, we even improve the reputation, and we have the courage to do it in across all levels of the society, all levels of professions, and we're not shy about wanting to achieve things here and showing that we can do a lot as people and as professionals.
A couple of stats as well from me. I mean, when we speak about contribution, I think it's there's a Guardian cover of the Guardian, I think 2 years ago. With a big title, the M word, as the people who helped Britain recover from the crisis, as the M word, the migrants. When we think about the economic contribution, we know that it's the ONS data. It's not we making it up as we go. Migrants from the new member states make a positive net contribution of £2.5 billion a year. For those of you not familiar with stats, that's I think twice and a half the size of the budget of the NHS England. So that's a lot. And we know that because they pay in and taxes £3.1 billion a year and take off £0.6 billion in benefits, which clearly sort of shows that the benefit-seeking Poles concept is just not true. But also, I think it's really important that we just had new stats released last week. There are more than 35,000 Polish companies in this country, some of them with colourful names. I recommend you to check that, because that's really an interesting read when you read some of the names. But that's 35,000 companies. That's a lot who have Polish directors, and that's clearly a lot. So when we talk about Poles taking up someone else's jobs, it's often the case that Poles are now generating new jobs. I think we sort of need to be aware of that it may have been true 10 years ago or 12 years ago that Poles were coming here to take up jobs, but now they increasingly more often create new jobs for other people, not necessarily always Polish people. And there are a couple of businesses. There's a couple of stories they absolutely love. There's a story of a friend of mine. She came in 2004 as a cleaner, not speaking English at all, working in one of the hotels in central London. After a couple of years, she was like, I don't really like it, I don't integrate here well, I will go back to Poland. She did. After 2 weeks in Poland, she decided that she wanted to come back to the UK. Now, fast forward 10 years later, she's running her own cafe in London, employing 6 people, half of them Polish, half of them English. Very successful one. They're planning to open a new one. So if I think about the Polish contribution to the UK, it's a story of transition that starts in 2004 when people were coming here desperately taking jobs, often way below their qualifications and skills, but this has changed, and we need to acknowledge that.
Thank you. I would just add one point of my own, which is that what always strikes me, polls in the UK, is the interest in becoming a part of British society, the interest in becoming British, at least in some measure, without losing their Polishness, throwing themselves into the current of British culture and creating, I think, what becomes a distinctive British-Polish culture that exists here now in towns and cities across the country with all kinds of different manifestations and adding to that the texture of British life more broadly. Please raise your hand if you would like to make a comment or ask a question of one of our panelists.
Hi, I'm not Polish, but I'm learning Polish. I was just wondering. Oh. So, thank you. So, I was just wondering, in the pursuit of this vigorous sort of assertion, or in this vigorous assertion of Poles are here, they're contributing, and so on, are there any attempts to actually reach out to other communities that, quite frankly, are equally suffering, and most people can't probably tell the difference? And it'd be interesting to hear from the ambassadors, because it can also happen at that level. I'm thinking of, you know, people from the Baltic states, people even, I don't know, from Slovakia or whatever. I mean, is there a way in which this can become a bigger conversation about Britain and European peoples rather than one, albeit very wonderful, people?
So what I'd say, the Financial Times article I mentioned earlier, it was an article about Polish people, but as you say, this has morphed into a discussion about the EU as a whole, and I think that can be a part of a bigger discussion. We're probably very focused on the Polish people because there is such a big group of Polish people here. It's a critical mass on its own. But as I said, especially the Brexit issue and sort of feelings of people and attitudes of people towards that and certain forms of, you know, maybe feeling a little uneasy or certain comments that some people may hear and so on. So that's not only limited to the Polish people, because I see similar feedback from other nations. Well, it's probably it's not for me to opine on how, you know, you can coordinate this with the other nations. But as I said, once you touch the subject, once you start talking about it, other people say, oh, that goes for us as well. That's, you know, we're in the same position. We're in the same boat.
Just to add on that, I think you're right in saying that in the years before the referendum, there's not much acknowledgement from the Polish community and from the other communities that Poles and Slovaks and Lithuanians and Estonians can do things together, which is quite contrary to the sort of idea that Eastern European people live in cliques or some sort of small closed groups, because in fact we frankly don't know much about each other, as in Poles about Lithuanians and Poles about Slovaks or whatever. And I personally love Czech and Slovak restaurant in London, but that may not be enough. The good thing is that, and I think it's as ironic as it sounds, there's some positive legacy of Brexit that we've seen in recent months, people of Eastern European background organizing together for the first time, coming together, regardless of the nationality, saying, okay, actually we have some interests that we can protect together. In Harlow, for example, there's a new organization coming up. They organized themselves after the killing of Polish men there. It's a group of people from different countries. They're not only Polish. They finally realized that there's more in common than divide them. So they have to work together to secure some of these rights. And I think that's a very good thing if we keep it up, basically. But also, one of the really good things that I see, and I think it's also good for the British people, is that increasing number of Poles and Eastern Europeans join labor unions. It's good because, in my opinion, or actually I don't have opinions, some people may have that opinion, which I may or may not believe that's true, that it's good because whenever there's an argument that Polish people undercut any sort of standards or services or whatever, if you join union, you're all represented together and you act together, And that quite often Polish workers, now I know that the major unions quite often approach them and ask them to join the unions, which especially was highlighted in Harlow. I mean, when I went to Harlow for the first time, I realized that a majority of Polish population there literally worked in three factories. And they were obviously not unionized in any way. Now, again, I know that there have been attempts to unionize them by the unions. And if successful, that may bring them together with other people of similar interests to make sure that they can protect rights together.
Yeah, thank you. I had a thought. I'm not as authoritative as the others here, but I thought I'd throw it in and be interested in what you think about it. Because I wonder whether I detected in the question an element of the Polish community suffering here in the UK. Maybe I imagined it. But what the government is trying to do, what the government has done, is to put together an anti-hate crime strategy. Now, that's not about just the Polish communities. It's not just about other European communities. It's about all the communities who suffer from hate crime. And the definition of hate crime is enormously broad. If there's a crime that happens and anybody, whether it's the victim or someone who sees it, perceives it as being even in very small part motivated by hatred or by the differences of that person, then it's a hate crime. And this strategy embraces hate crimes for people who are of different ethnicity, different religions, people who are handicapped, people of different sexual orientations, different people of different sexual identities as well. And the sorts of things we're talking about now to make sure that Polish people are protected, I think can apply and does apply the same to those other groups as well. And what I think is really important is that we find answers as the UK to make sure that everyone feels safe here. And I think the examples we're talking about right now are a very specific one around the Polish community. But I think that's the principle, and that is the one which I know that the Home Office are talking about, are working on right now. And slightly more controversially, and please don't misunderstand this, but we were chatting earlier on about the number of cases of hate crime that there are in the UK and how they've been covered in the media. Now, one case of hate crime is too many, particularly against the Polish community. But as we were talking about, it's a community of 86, 84, I forget, 1,000 people. We must make sure none of them suffer. The number of cases, I think, that the Polish embassy had registered was 38. Now, let's imagine that that's a very small percentage of the overall number. I think it's important to have a little element of and a scale when we talk about this as well. Now, underlying that as well is that I think the thought, and I promise I'll finish here because otherwise I'll go on and on. I think the importance is how safe, what I said before, is people feeling safe. So again, to contradict myself a little bit, it's not just about the numbers, it's also about everybody knowing they can live here and feel safe. And I think that's one of the basic things that the government wants to achieve. So I'm sorry for being a little bit round and round in that, but those are some things which occurred to me as you were speaking. Thanks, Stanley.
Yeah, I mean, that just as much as I hate to disagree with Ambassador, I just wanted to highlight that the number of 38 is incidents of hate crime that were serious enough to be taken to the embassy or the consulate. But we know that the number of incidents involving Polish citizens is much, much higher. Yeah, I mean, it's still obviously, we need to keep in mind the proportion. You're absolutely right in that. I think the narrative created by some reports that there's some sort of very, very negative situation of Poles in this country, they're not safe, is just not true. And we need to repeat that as often as possible so that we, as Elizabeth said, don't give up to the hysteria about it. But coming back to the point about allies, I just want to add one thing. And you rightly said that hate crimes are not only against Polish people, but against all sort of communities. And I think the situation also showed us that the Polish community have some, for some people, unexpected allies. I remember the first community that condemned attacks on Polish people in the UK were the Muslims. And the wonderful, wonderful organization that is Tell Mama that report all incidents of hate crime on Muslims. And there was a wonderful moment when communities of different sort, of different backgrounds, decided to stand together and say, you know what, actually, in the light of hate crime that we sort of face now, we're all together, we need to stand together, because, what, as you said, I mean, one incident of hate crime is one too many.
Another question? Comment.
Thank you very much. Really, I'd like to make a comment, but also a proposal. History likes to repeat itself, and after the Second World War, despite all the sacrifice of the Polish military in defense of Western democracy, Poles were demonized and denigrated in England and told to go bugger off back home to communist jails and torture. And now we're seeing exactly the same thing happening again. The narrative about Poles is again demonization and denigration, and is driven by the mass media. Nobody reads the Financial Times outside the City of London. The Daily Mail, the Daily Express, the Sun, the Star, all the mass media. Every day you see negative reporting about migration to the United Kingdom and its effects. My proposal is that Polish embassy and the Czech embassy and the Bulgarian embassy, all the East European embassies, should have a massive media campaign to actually tell the truth of what the contribution of all those citizens is in the United Kingdom. And it's actually a fantastic story. In my opinion, these people subsidize British jobs because they create fantastic work ethic, productivity is up, profitability of these companies is up, and they actually subsidize the British workplace through their efforts. Many companies probably would go bankrupt if it wasn't for the East European workforce. And I think many employers would actually say that. And that's the story we need to get out.
To your proposals, I would start from a very simple solution. I know Jakub will talk about media because that's a separate issue. What I would propose and suggest, and that's obviously for DFS to consider, as you might know, history, geography as a subject is not compulsory in this country. And I think that's where it starts. It all starts from the awareness and education of people, of young people in particular. So I suppose until we introduce history and geography as a compulsory subject in all secondary schools, we will be ending up having a society which is basically misinformed, and you can talk about media and their impact.
Yeah. Just to quickly say that the, I don't know if any of you have seen the campaign which has been running called the Stop Funding Hate campaign, which is tackling kind of Waitrose, Sainsbury's, John Lewis, etc., to try and get them to pull advertising from the Daily Mail, the Daily Express, etc. And I was just thinking earlier on, so you know, 960 or 80 or nearly a million people, that's a lot. But what does that translate into? Well, in electoral terms, well, if you don't get right to vote in general elections, not so much, but as consumers, that's a lot. That's a lot. And, you know, I would like to see that campaign getting a bit more traction to actually make some of our major companies, and particularly the ones that claim, like John Lewis, to have ethical approaches to what they do, that they should pull their advertising from the Daily Mail and the Daily Express. And I think it would be a really interesting twist on that to see that coming from particularly within the Polish community or elsewhere.
Yeah, could you have a quick word? But in the meantime, we'll see
if
we have another question coming.
Yeah, so about media. Well, that's a tricky one. I fully agree. I mean, the articles in the FT, we've had four or five articles in the FT now about Polish contribution to this country. I have, in one way or another, contributed to some of them. Then the same goes for The Guardian, where some of you may have seen in the last month there was a special issue about Polish people in the UK, which again I have contributed to, which was in with a Polish word on top of the cover of the newspaper saying Cześć in Polish, with a Polish national emblem, and then a special issue inside the paper as well explaining who the Polish people are in the UK and what they do. this is important, this has built the awareness, but I fully agree that this is partially preaching to the converted, and we need to get out and speak to people who read the Mail, the Sun, the Express, and we need to find ways to communicate with them. I mean, I have personally made the sacrifice of going to different drinking halls in London to meet journalists from these wonderful papers in the last couple of weeks and months, to be able to tell them at least some examples of Polish contribution to this country, quite sometimes successfully, sometimes not yet successfully. But I think it's a lot about that, about personal connection, about telling these people the stories and showing them the stories. I think it's not necessarily always, and I would defend them even though it's difficult for me, that I wouldn't say that the most of the journalists are racist or xenophobic or whatever, they just don't know Polish people. And I think it's really important to show them the positive contribution they make. And from my experience, they're quite receptive to that. When you tell them, for example, that Polish schools that people work voluntarily in and they pay for school to be rented for them on Saturdays, which make a positive contribution to the school's budget, blah, 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 they're like, oh, actually, that's a good idea. That's a good thing. So they just don't know that. And we need to talk to them as often as possible to explain that to them, that this is happening, because otherwise we'll end up having covers about migrant lorry drivers and things like that, which are unacceptable. So we need to speak to them, and we need to explain the situation as often as possible.
I came to England 40 years ago, and at the beginning, I'm Polish, by the way, you can hear it from my accent, of course. And to begin with, I had to go to Alien's office in London, and I had a card which says Alien. Well, I created my home here, and I have two children, two sons. I used to make a joke occasionally, your dad is an alien, and I can approve, here's a card. Of course, it became my home, and I feel at home here. And day after referendum, my son called me at 6 o'clock in the morning, petrified. 6 o'clock in the morning at that age group, he's in his 20s, that's really incredible. And he was petrified. And then he said something, he said to me, they turn you into alien again, yeah? And I think that's one of those aspects, like you think you were at home, forget it now. Now is another world. And I don't feel offended or anything like this, but and my answer was, you have to, because he was also upset about the loss of choice, because now he's British. So it became, in a sense, it put in a new situation. And he asked me, what do I need to do now? And I said, well, your choices changed. You have to adapt. It's the only answer. I just wanted to throw it in, basically.
Thank you. I think Jakub has a comment, but we haven't heard from Aneta for some time. Would you like to respond to any of the issues that have just come up?
There's been quite a lot of things mentioned here, but I think what I'd probably like to comment on is we've discussed this campaign in the media campaign, and Jakub is doing a great job in the media himself. So it's very important for us as a Polish community to have a voice, and it's a very big community, and I think we have not been as well represented as other communities in the UK, and it's sort of falls onto every single one of us in terms of representing ourselves towards the people we are on a daily basis, but it also falls onto improving the image, strengthening the image in the media, and actually becoming a strong voice which is respected, and a voice that when we say something, then there is a strong reaction on the political level and so on. And I know that aside from obviously Jakub, the Polish embassy is doing a lot of work in that respect and is doing very well, but I think in general, just strengthening the power of the 1 million people who are, it's a huge group, and we said it's a big consumer group, it's such a big minority, and it's not been maybe as organized or as as expressive or maybe just as self-confident as the other groups. And I think it's very important that we are as, again, confident in ourselves, and that we realize we have the same rights, and then that we have, you know, the same ambitions, and we have the right to contribute, but we also have the right to, you know, to be respected and to be a fully functioning part of the society that's being
No, jestem Anglikiem, ale teraz mówię po polsku. No, po angielsku, dziękuję. I'm definitely not speaking Polish. I'd just like to pick up on our former UFO, my experience on 23rd of June, because I was actually in Poland on the 23rd of June. I did vote leave. My wife is Polish. I did vote leave. However, the reaction, obviously, I was witnessing everything unfolding over here while I was in Poland, and I just felt, I turned to my wife while over there, and I said to her, I don't know if I want to go back home, because it just didn't feel like the Britain that I know, welcoming, tolerant. It just didn't feel like that at all, and I just wanted to pick up on your reaction, you know, your son's reaction, phoning you at 6 o'clock in the morning. But it just, so there's a flip side to it of how English people who are involved with the Polish community, married to them or have children with them, how we Brits feel within the Polish community. My feelings since June have shifted dramatically on witnessing hopefully a minority of people's reactions. I agree 38 is a underestimation of what we've seen. But yeah, I just wanted to reassure anyone present that we Brits, are alongside you and sympathise, basically.
Thank you for those words.
Kenneth? Can I just follow up on that? I mean, I think it is really important to think about what the Brexit vote means, and you know, for a lot of people, it's not about a rejection of people; it's a rejection of institutions. It's about a rejection of a set of institutions that are either not very well understood or understood all too well. And I think when we then think about where things move forward from here, I think there is then an important job of work to be done, again, in terms of just thinking about voice and how you exercise voice and where you exercise voice, to say, for that voice to be turned not just to UK institutions to ask and to demand, you know, to know what's going to happen next, but also to do that to the EU institutions and say, okay, what responsibility are you going to have for this situation occurring, and what responsibility are you going to take for the rest of the EU 27 moving forward? How are you going to reform and change? And looking forward to next year's elections in France, let's be honest, if Marine Le Pen gets anywhere close to the French presidency, the function of the EU is, to my mind, defunct. It's defunct not because it can't organise trade relations and all the rest of it. That's, anybody can do that. The whole point of the EU is to act as a binding mechanism amongst disparate European states to impose some helpful discipline in some ways, to tame nationalism, to tame these forces. If the European Union cannot do that, and we end up in a situation that Marine Le Pen gets anywhere close to the French presidency, then that has failed as a project. And I do believe that it's important that the European Union learn some important lessons to strengthen itself in order to allow member states to be strengthened internally as well, to ensure that the kind of forces that we see, because the forces we see in the UK post-Brexit aren't just purely British, they're elsewhere in Europe. There's a real danger and what's happening in Europe, and we need to be careful not to isolate. It's too easy to blame this as a British Brexit problem. There's a wider issue out there.
Thank you. No, Jakub wants to say something, but let's just get another question from the floor here, if we may.
Sorry, not a question. I just wanted to make a comment that before 2004, British press and British economy was crying for key workers. And we had a big, big problem here because of the housing problems, and the key workers was the big word, and the economy was going down in a way. So we should analyze what happened since then and what contribution the immigrants did, and the East European immigrants, Polish and other East European immigrants did to the Polish economy. And perhaps press should take this point and see how these people are putting up with the atrocious housing problems which they're facing, and how they're fighting their sort of personal lives in order to survive and boost the British economy. Thank you.
Jakub, thank you.
It's always the media, right? I personally do take note of that. And I think you're right in saying that whilst we know from economic point of view that EU migrants from new member states have contributed every single year since 2004 to the British budget. It was every single year, it was a positive contribution. We have had some external events like financial crisis of 2008, which has changed the government's policy on many issues, including housing, for example, which is one of the reasons why today many people feel like the housing problem was aggravated or created by migrants, which in fact that's not necessarily true, because there are sort of external reasons, and this is way more complex. And I agree with you that media should take note of that and try to explain that in a more elaborate way, and try to say that more clearly, that it's not EU migrants who take the house, and that it's not EU migrants. That's the reason why people have problems with buying houses. That's just not the same thing. So.
Elizabeth, did you want to comment?
Oh, I'm just going to say I'll throw a spanner in the works, I suppose, but it just goes down to education again, doesn't it? Because media only print what sells and what people will buy and what people, or in according to media, what they want to read. So I think you need to... Of course, you know why. So it's still, you know, I know it sounds boring, but it's still down to education. Education of the whole nation, of all the communities, and bringing the facts down, remembering the past, you know, remembering the history of all the nations, of all the communities, of the, you know, empire that contributed to this land.
Thank you.
Kind of following on from the idea of education, I was thinking that actually Poland seems to have been forgotten a bit in this discourse, and I was wondering if the panel, including ambassadors, thinks that maybe we could try to raise awareness of the other EU countries that supposedly Britain has rejected, rather than kind of turning in ourselves, looking out to see where the kind of million odd people are from, and seeing how links can maybe be created. I think post-Brexit we're seeing opportunities for trade with countries which we haven't generally seen as trade partners, and perhaps we can see different countries in the EU as trade partners as well. But on a more general level, just learning a bit more about Poland. I mean, I'm a student of Polish this year, and I just think as an interesting country, and I suppose that kind of follows on from Elizabeth's point about education, but I'd be interested to hear what you think.
Thank you.
Absolutely, thank you very much. You know, it's it's down to what we do about the whole Brexit thing and how we embrace that. I can tell you when I arrived to the UK 12 years ago, my partner, who's British, who also voted Leave, by the way, to and also just to vote to my predecessor, I had my colleague teachers coming to me on the 24th of June and apologising, saying literally, Elizabeth, we are ever so sorry, we absolutely good and the rest of it. But I think what it's all in our hands, okay, and I'm just trying to think that, you know, It's really down to us all and working together that we can make that difference. And you can make these things happen. I've been doing raising awareness about the Polish community amongst the West Midlands police forces, and they absolutely love it. So the willingness is there, but you have to make that first step. And you have to offer something in the first place to actually see these things happening. Because I think that the will is there, even more so now after Brexit, surprisingly, than it was perhaps before. So let's use that as an opportunity.
Now, it's obviously very easy to take Brexit vote personally and think that it was a vote against us. But we can see even from this discussion here now, there's a lot of Leave voters who actually stay on the same side as we do in this debate, and that these are sort of natural allies for us to work on education and things like that. And I strongly believe that there are people who voted Leave on the 23rd of June, and now they think like, well, we voted to leave the EU, but we did not vote to leave Europe. So, and this is the sort of thing that they regularly say, and maybe it's actually true. I mean, maybe there are people out of this 52%, maybe some segment of that group, are people who are willing to help us with sort of educating people about Poland, Slovakia, Lithuania, Estonia, France, and just making sure that even after Brexit, these links are still there, and people, Polish people, other people say, okay, can live here and work here, and it still can work in a pretty good way even without the European Union. I think it's by denying Brexit and saying, oh, Brexit is bad and it's just deluded people and it shouldn't happen, we're not making progress here. And I think I agree with Elizabeth. I mean, the vote happened on the 23rd of June. It's just decision done. We need to think about what we can do after Brexit to make sure these links actually are strengthened.
Another question here.
Yeah. Well, so on a sort of slightly similar note, but also connecting to the idea of the European Union perhaps being seen as defunct in a year from now, or perhaps already, I was wondering, you know, if partly EU is not just a victim of its own success with the freedom of movement. So we have the 1 million of Polish people in the UK, and I think, you know, vast majority of them are not British citizens, so cannot vote in the British elections, and also had abysmal record from what I remember in voting Polish elections, so essentially are not heard at all. And who will be the people who are most gaining from freedom of movement? Are the people who actually moved and stayed? They are the ones who are sort of gaining, and they either don't want to vote or cannot vote, as in the Brexit referendum, the British people were not allowed to vote. And I don't think there is a solution in terms of actually giving the vote. It seems politically impossible, but the only solution I guess there is to try and sort of gain this voice and try and find some ways in engaging more in the country where we are, rather than, so it's natural, this also ties in, I guess, what was said before, that, and it's a very natural instinct for someone who is a professional, who is an academic, to think, oh, we can just go now and find a better place to live, where it's sort of it's more welcoming. It's very natural instinct for me, but if we all do that, then us, the people who are actually, you know, benefiting from that, will never be heard. We never stay somewhere and try and make a point and sort of try and make a stand in a way. And I think that's something I was thinking a lot about recently.
Kenneth, you want to?
I think there's a really interesting but difficult point to be made, which is that, you know, you're saying about the kind of the success of the European Union. Of course, the European Union, like other organisations, is successful in the sense that it's allowed certain things to move, and there's now a kind of more global economy. But while all that's taking place, our fundamental political structures have remained national, and they then become quite hard mechanisms for then dealing with problems and issues in that whole system. They can't internalize really what's going on elsewhere. And these questions about franchise become important, I think, because if you cannot vote in a general election in a country in which you're resident, you don't want to give up your nationality, but you live there, you pay your taxes there, but you don't have a voice. Really? How can that work? You know, that sort of thing. So I think we often think about the kind of financial crisis in the EU, and we say, oh, there's this big asymmetry between centralizing monetary power in the central bank and yet having all these economies at national level running around. Well, the same is true of politics. You know, if the economy is working at a global level, but the politics remains national and cannot allow people to deal with the externalities that are created by shifts in movement and all the rest of it, then we'll have a problem. How you fix that then requires a different sort of leap of imagination that I don't think anybody is ready for. For some, that is then the federal future. I don't believe that. I don't think that's going to work. But I think national politics has to be better at doing European politics. And that European politics then has to be one that does actually understand what is going on elsewhere. Why is it in the UK we're obsessed by the US presidential? We probably know more about American politics than we know about the politics of our nearest neighbours. You know, so, and I'm not using that as media blame. I'm just meaning that in terms of, it's amazing what we ourselves do and what our obsessions are.
Thank you.
That's just a peculiarly British I'm pretty confident in Poland they know a lot more about the US elections than they do, even with a million people here, about British politics. In France, I'm pretty sure. In Germany, I'm pretty sure. In Spain, I'm pretty sure. Not that it undermines your point, but I don't think that's a peculiarly British thing. Since I've got the microphone, I try not to take it too often. Just two things. One is to remember what the Prime Minister said about the rights of Poles, the rights of EU citizens in the UK who are here. What she said is, I would like to guarantee the people who are in the UK the rights they've currently got. But in order to make that guarantee, I need the other EU member states to guarantee the same rights for British people in those countries. That is what she said, and let me leave it there. We can talk about that as well, but that's what she said. The second thing I think it's really important to remember, and I'm really, really happy it came up, is that Brexit isn't the end of Britain in Europe. It's not the end, in particular, of Britain in NATO. It's in particular not the end of a UK relationship with Poland and British people's relationship with Polish people. And I really like the ideas that you were talking about earlier on, that the question is how we're going to develop those. I like those because a big part of that is, frankly, my job and Arkady's job right now. So that I think is the frame of mind to be in as we look towards the medium range. And that's what our governments want to do, which I think is, I mean, I would say that anyway, I guess, but genuinely believe is right.
Thank you. Aneta.
If I may, to add to that, I think one thing we're often forgetting about is we're talking about 1 million Polish people who came here, but we're treating everybody as migrants who sort of have come here and will sort of stay forever. But I think what's very important is that, you know, some people come here because they think it's a great place to improve their skills, learn the language, to start their career, or do the university studies and then go back or go somewhere else. And I think it's this sort of freedom of movement that has been so precious, because we obviously can say we guaranteed the rights to everybody who's here, but it's also a value when people come back, sort of, when there's this sort of movement of people and then movement of experiences. And as Jakub has given the example of his friends, sort of came here, went back, came here again, and that's enriching. And also commenting on my previous comments, you know, it's not that, of course, I don't want to say that we can, now there's Brexit, so we all go home, and, or, you know, we have a choice, we feel offended, we go home. But I would like us to remember that, you know, there is a real choice, and it's, you know, we are all responsible for our choices. So if we choose to stay here, then we should sort of try to make it as you know, as successful as possible, as good for ourselves and for others as possible. But also, as I said, there is a choice, and there are great opportunities in Poland. The country is growing enormously, and I know a lot of professionals, and I mean professionals, people who have been educated here, or even students who have been educated here, who say, you know, I want to go back to Poland after university because I know I'll have a better start, or they say I want to work for like 2-3 years in the city, just a good start, and then go back because I know my career will be faster. So it is not one-way movement. It's actually two-way movement, and that's the precious part, I think. And as I just mentioned, you know, there are lots of, for instance, students in the UK, and they are getting the best education here possible, and then go back the freedom for them to go back, work in Poland a little bit, come back again, work a little bit here, that is the precious thing. So it's not only about the people who have already come and stayed.
A few more words from the ambassador.
Can I come in and agree with that? Not to disagree, but again, looking forward, I think there's a danger in interpreting Brexit as not allowing EU nationals to come into the UK. Because we don't know what the scenario is going to be, of course. For me, I think it is very, very, very unlikely the Polish people, well, to exaggerate, to make a point, Polish people won't be barred from coming into the UK. It won't be the same as it's now. Again, as the government has said, that's one of the messages from the referendum.
We are recording this event. No, we hear this statement.
But I think I'm almost quoting the Prime Minister, so I feel on pretty safe ground. We don't know what the outcome is. All we know is it's not absolutely status quo. So I think there's a danger of looking forward and seeing the worst possible scenario, because I certainly personally hope and believe that we won't be near that. So I think as we think about the future, let's not be completely negative about it.
Ambassador Rzegocki, a few words.
I wanted to say just a few words. Thank you for the discussion and for a wonderful opportunity to talk. And I fully agree with all of the UN, especially with Jonathan. But it's not only our work. It's not only our work to make Polish-British relations better than in the past, but it's our common task, and to use this challenge as opportunity, as Elizabeth said, that's our task. And thank you for this meeting. Thank you for all your supporting of every idea, every activity which bring British people close to Poland and Polish people close to British. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a lot of hands going up. There was one hand at the back there a while back. If we could, let's just gather those questions, and then I think we want to conclude and continue this over wine upstairs. But let's just gather some questions rapidly. Please try to be succinct as you can.
I'll try. My name is Anya. I was born here, but to Polish parents, I can speak Polish. So I've seen from all sides. So firstly, I think it's very important for Poles to feel at home here, because from speaking to some of them, they don't actually feel at home in Poland with what's going on in Poland as well. What's sweeping in England is also sweeping across Europe. We've touched upon it. What's happening in France is also happening in Poland. So some people also feel very sad at what's happening there as well, and they don't feel they don't recognize their home. And that's why it's also important for them to feel that they're at home here. And probably what you're saying about the identity, there is a British-Polish identity being created now, and that's important. Second of all, there's many different voices in England, different Poles, from the generations from who came after the Second World War, to my parents' generation who came 30, 40 years ago, to the present generation. So it's quite tricky to make all those voices heard and to build links between those generations of Poles and also between Poles and the Brits. So thank you.
Thank you very much for those comments. Vanessa, do you want to finish what you were saying while we...
Oh, if I may, Ambassador Knott, I wasn't suggesting it's not going to be possible to come to Britain. I just thought that in the current situation, it's just very easy to come and go and sort of move around within the EU. And I guess that's a great thing. I'm sure there will be ways to come back, maybe to be a bit more administrative, but the fact that it's been so easy and everybody who's been migrating like us has loved the fact that it's, you don't need a visa, you don't need any administrative papers, you can just come work here and then move to Germany. I mean, I've lived actually personally, I've before I came to the UK, I lived, studied in France for a year, then I was in the UK for a year, then I was in Germany for a year, and then I came back. And so you know, that for me, that was wonderful. That was the best experience, ever, to have a chance to live in those countries. And I'm sure that's shaped me, and that's sort of helped my career and my view on life and so on. And so to have, for this to be possible in a relatively easy way, it's just a great benefit for everybody, for people who can do that and study in those different countries and do it, you know, and take it as a natural that you know that the Europe is so open that you can go to places, work there, study there, make experiences there, you know, marry there, do whatever you want. It's just a great feature.
Thank you. If a question.
Hi. Yeah, I just wanted to make a I'm Polish and I've lived here for 8 years, and I wanted to make a general comment about the EU and the reputation that the EU has amongst us. I feel that the Leave Remain campaign was really unequal. I feel that the Remain campaign actually didn't show the real benefits of the EU on the personal level. And what we can clearly see by looking at Google results and Google searches on the next day, it seems like people didn't really understand what the EU is all about, what benefits we actually have. I think some British people didn't understand that the EU gives them easy holidays, you know, traveling to Spain or to, you know, easy trips to Amsterdam, or you know, they can even retire in Spain thanks to the EU. So I feel that we don't really stress all the advantages the EU gives us. Me personally, I just wanted to share a few life facts about myself, because I'm an Erasmus student. This was my first longer European experience, let's say, being abroad. That's where I met my husband. And then we decided to move to the UK as this friendly, multinational country. And that's where our daughter was born, and she's half Australian, half British. And then, I guess she's a third Australian, third British, and third Polish. She has three passports, and I believe that I belong to this generation of people who just love the EU. I love this whole multicultural environment, and I want to just, you know, carry on living this way, because this is my life. And I feel that this referendum broke my life a little bit, and I'm really upset about it. And I'm not sure about the future of my daughter at the moment. And my husband and I, because we have this option, we're thinking about moving to Australia now, because it seems like a slightly more friendly place to be in, maybe. So I just wanted to share the story with you, because it's about you made my life, created who I am now, and I just love this institution.
I won't betray my own origins. Let's finish with two questions and two comments, brief ones at the front here, and then some final remarks from the panel. As brief as you can, if you could.
Okay. Well, one thing which I'd like to say is that it's wonderful to talk about the calls in Britain and our lives, but somehow it's also the great process which is happening all around us, I think. And we are living really interesting times altogether, and maybe the times of one country, for one nation, is coming to, it's being shaken quite a bit. And this globalization perhaps happens too fast for some and requires a lot of changes and changes of mentality. It might just need a little bit more time, a little bit more maybe tolerance and understanding, not only what's happening between Poles and Brits, but what's happening in general between nations, how we can, you know, as people say, just build bridges and kind of create more of just unity, humanity, you know, because that's the world seems to go. So I find it very exciting that, and it seems to be unstoppable. People will travel, people will look for a better life, or, you know, they will fall in love with guys they didn't expect to. But that's life, you know, that's life. They will speak different languages, you know, my husband still can speak Polish, but that's how it happened. I love my country, but I love my husband as well.
Thank you. A final comment.
I kind of wish you'd gone last, because yours is much better to end on. Mine's a bit boring in comparison. I just wanted to ask, because we've heard a little bit about the previous waves of Polish migrants and a bit about their experience. I was wondering if broadly there had been any significant differences in how Poles who came after 2004 have experienced hate since Brexit and sort of lived here a lot longer. But also to ask if there is much discussion between these different generations about it, and if anything was coming out of that, about how to deal with it, or how to help each other, or how British people can help. about all those different conversations? Are they happening? What's coming out of that?
If we could just have a quick word from each member of the panel to conclude, perhaps starting with Elizabeth, if you could possibly respond to that question if you'd like.
Just to finish off, I've just found something very nice written by the Chief Executive of the National Resource Centre for Supplementary Education. A positive attitude will lead to positive outcomes. Well, let's stick to that, and life will go on. Just to echo what I've said before. In terms of the generation, that's a very, the three generations, we could talk for England about these three generations. So I think what we have to realise here is the differences in the migration itself. When you're talking about the Second World War, when they were forced because they couldn't go back because they would get killed, then you've got the 80s, political reasons, then you've got 2004, which is purely economic. Totally different scenarios, totally different reality and environment, these waves of migration, experience. But one thing that remains the same, it's moving borders, one way or the other, finding life where we live, where we want to feel welcomed, where we want to feel settled, and you make your own home wherever you go, and it's up to you. So I'll just keep saying that, okay?
Thank you.
So on the generational sort of debate, we know that the approximately 1/8 of the force in the UK in fact supported Brexit. And these were mostly people of older generations, but not the older generations. So from the research we know that these are the people who came to the UK in the 60s, 70s, 80s. But the older generations mostly in favour of Remain, saying that that was fought for, that they would stay. Then these the later generations said, oh, we want to leave action. So something that they call the bus logic. So if you wait for a bus and the bus stop, you want to get into the bus, whilst you're in the bus, you just want the bus doors to remain closed.
And then obviously the newer sort of generation overwhelmingly remain. Now, if there's enough debate, I don't think so, no. I think one of the biggest problems with the Polish community at the moment, that's something we addressed last year as well, is lack of generational links between communities. And we don't have enough opportunities to discuss that between communities, between the generations. I think that's a big, big problem. It's something we need to address as well, to understand why some people who have happened to have British citizenship, the people who came here in the 60s, 70s, they actually voted leave. But I want to come back quickly to the point you made about politics before. I think one of the most underreported stories of 2016 is Sadiq Khan's win in London mayoral election. The margin, the victory margin between Sadiq Khan and Zach Goldsmith was significantly smaller than the number of EU citizens allowed to vote in that election. And whilst we obviously need to make for the research, I wonder if that's available, it is quite likely that EU citizens, who many of them thought about the election as a sort of referendum, because they could vote in the London mayor election, they could not vote in the referendum itself, thought of it as a referendum, they voted for Sadiq Khan just because of that reason. I think it's very likely that was I would say, probably the first decision in British politics ever which was made. Including a very significant number of European voters taking part in that election. I fully agree that we need to increase political activity of the Polish community. We have only one Polish MP at the moment. Two, actually. Rosina Alin Khan is half Polish, half Pakistani. Three, who's the third one?
Yeah, there's one among them in the Labour Party, the Polish Sheriff.
Oh, Polish Sheriff, yes. She's half Polish as well. But I'm speaking as if... the recent sort of wave of migrants to the UK, I would expect them to be more politically active in the years to come, but first they need to get permits, as in permanent residence and citizenship. So this process, which we hope to happen in the next 2 or 3 years, may be a bit delayed, but I would expect that to happen in the next couple of years, that more and more Polish citizens who have become British citizens will be standing in elections, especially at local level.
Thank you.
What I'd say in closing is that, generally speaking, the British are a very smart nation, and I'm sure they will negotiate good terms for Brexit, and there will be as little disruption as possible, and London will remain a great city to live in, especially as a great world city, and we will not have as much impact in terms of negative impact in terms of economic growth as we might have feared. So I'm very trusting here that the British will do well in that respect, and the Polish, on the other hand, they are hardworking and adaptable. So I'm sure they will continue to do well and integrate and sort of prove their themselves in the British society. So I would say I'm very optimistic about the future, despite the sort of little jitters that came in the form of the Brexit. I'm sure the Britain will do well, and the Polish and the Brit in the UK will do well as well.
Thank you. I think the only thing I want to say is actually to respond to the important thing that Ambassador Knott said, and the statement you made, which was the Prime Minister's statement, which is the most important thing that has been said, I think, about the relative, the protection of rights for EU nationals in the UK. So what I'm about to say is not a criticism of you, but a criticism of the statement. The statement being that, you know, we will want to see protection of rights for EU nationals in the UK so long as we get protection, similar protections for UK nationals in the EU. That seems like a very simple principle of fairness. But it's taking the logic of a trade negotiation to talk about people's lives. Yeah, it's one thing to say, well, we'll take your cars if you take ours. But what is so important about tonight, I mean, the thing that I'm most struck by tonight, is just individual lives and stories of people's lives of moving and being in other places. And these are not tradable. You can't trade these away. And I think our government should just very simply and straightforwardly say, as a self-description of who the UK is, even in light of the Brexit vote, is to say, we absolutely guarantee these, whether or not Spain guarantees these rights to UK pensioners or not, because it's a statement about who we are. Whether a different country wants to make a statement about who they are is entirely up to them. And I do not accept the logic that is implicit in that statement, that these are somehow negotiable or tradable, and I don't think anything that we've heard tonight from the people in this room would support that view.
But first of all, could you please join me in thanking Ambassador Rzegocki and Ambassador Knott for joining us this evening for this discussion. And could you please thank our panelists, Aneta, Buchert, Kenneth Armstrong, Jakub Krupa, and Elizabeth Kardynal. And finally, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank a great poll in the UK without whom none of the Polish studies events could take place, and that's our wonderful departmental secretary, Olga Puchaniczak, here. Please thank her. And thank you to all of you for coming along. Please look at our website. If you Google Cambridge Polish Studies, you'll find us, and you'll find information on future events as we get closer to those times. And now, if you go through that door, follow the stairs, there's wine.
But before, I think we owe thanks to the organizers as well, so please join me.